session in future club, and he's going to talk about how non-positive hurt is mapping class group.
Thank you for the invitation to speak. So the mapping class group does depend on the surface you give me. So I'm going to denote by S the surface of GST with P marked points. So, question, is the mapping class group a cat zero group? In general, the answer is no. And this is a theorem due to calculation from V, and later Martin Brighton. And in general, in particular in the genuses at least 3, mod S is not cat zero. What does cat zero mean? It just means the group acts properly and co-compactly by isometries on some cat zero space. Now, all the actions in this talk can be assumed to be by isometries and by semi-simple isometries, if you wish. In general, the mapping class group is not cat zero. Also, when the genus is 2 and the surface is punctured, the same theorem holds. I'm not sure what's going on in genus 1, but you can also ask this question in the case of genus 0. And particularly, you can ask this question for the Bray groups. When n is at most 6, in other words, you have at most 6 strands, then the answer is yes. And this is the theorem of Eitel, Kielak, and Schwer. But when n is at least 7, this question is quite notorious, and the answer is still not known. You can also ask whether these groups are co-compact accumulated. And for n equals 4, the answer is no, even for its finite index subgroups. And this is proved by Wang, Yankievich, and Shititsky. And in general, by Thomas Python. Okay.
What are the hypotheses?
So this is n at least 4. And in fact, these guys, both groups, consider Arnhem groups in general. But in this talk, I'm not going to focus on the question of whether the group is cat zero. I'm interested in the extent to which the mapping class group acts on cat zero spaces. So first of all, let's rule out certain actions from the theorem of Brighton. So let the mapping class group act on some cat zero space, a complete cat zero space by semi-simple isometries, and suppose the dimension, the covering dimension of X is strictly less than G, and Brighton tells you there is a global fixed point. So in particular, if this action were co-compact, then X would have to have finite bounds. What about positive results? On the other hand, there are two natural actions of the mapping class group on cat zero spaces. G's the genus, yeah. Okay, so the first action I'd like to mention is for closed surfaces. There's a map to the symplectic group, and the symplectic group acts on a symmetric space, single space, which is cat zero. But there's a huge group here that does nothing, called the Torelli group. So you lose a ton of information, and in some sense, the Torelli group is harder than the mapping class group. So I'm not interested in that action. The second action comes from the Fahr-Peters symmetric untangler space. And this is cat zero. and this was proved independently by Trumbo and Walker in 1986. And this second space turns out to be very useful. So the action on type Lower space is proper, but it's not co-compact. It's not complete either, so let's take the completion. And then the action is co-compact, but it's not proper. It's dangerous fixed points. And the point is that this is a very useful space. So for instance, well, I suppose this is without the completion. Walker gives a proof of Nielsen realization. And secondly, Bites and shows that for any homomorphism from mod S to mod sigma, supposing that the genus of S is at least 3, then Dane twists get sent to roots of multi-twists. This is quite a deep theorem, and it is true for any homomorphism. And it's an important theorem too. So Ramayana and Suto use this theorem to classify all homomorphisms between certain Lapin class groups. So this is a very useful space, but it could be better. So I'd like to point out a very nice theorem of Daskalopoulos and Wentworth. They prove much things about the type Lower space, but here's one theorem. They prove that every pseudo-Anosov has a unique axis in the type Lower space, the Bob-Pierce symmetric, without the completion. This is a great theorem, and for some people, it's really good news. But for geometric group theorists, it's bad news. Because what I'd like to do is construct elements whose axes go in places where I want them to go. Okay? Let me be clear what I mean by this. So for example, in non-positively curved complexes, such as small cancellation groups, for example, you can cook up loxodromic elements and ensure that their axes go through certain vertices. And this sort of property helps you count elements as well. So this sort of picture where you cook up axes in an explicit way, this was sort of in Mahan's book when he was talking about trees. So this leads me to ask the following question. So for general mapping class groups, is there a co-compact action on a, let's say, piecewise Euclidean or piecewise hyperbolic, cut zero, polyhedral, or simplicial, complex, infinite dialogue. Okay. And, well, you see, the mapping class group is one of these mysterious groups where you have to work really hard to find new spaces. In particular, if such a complex is cat zero, it has to be contractible. And there aren't a great many complexes to act on that we already know and love. A particular complex of interest is the Arkin pair complex. measurements be asked, whether it can be cut out. And you can take this question to mean just any Katsura metric, or one that's invariant with respect to the action of the mapping class group. In either case, I still don't know the answer to this question. If you actually read their first paper, verbatim, they don't say arc and curve complex, they say arc complex. But it's clear that what they meant is the arc and curve complex. Okay? So we can still ask the same question. For the bona fide arc complex. And this explicit question does appear in the notes on the curve complex by Saul Schleimer, but I'm not entirely sure who to attribute the question to. It turns out in general that the answer is going to be no to this complex, and that's like the main theorem for this talk. So since I'm going to be talking about the arc complex in more detail, I should just very quickly define it. So an arc alpha is an isotopy class of embedded interval with endpoints that are marked. Such that these arcs alpha are not trivial.
I presume you allow endpoints at the same mark point?
It can connect this the same mark point, yeah. So properly embedded, I suppose I should say. So this arc here is allowed, but non-trivial just means something that's not isotopic into a mark point. So an arc like this is not allowed. So the mapping class group acts on the set of arcs, but there's more structure there. So the mapping class group will preserve the geometric intersection over between two arcs. That leads us onto the arc complex. And this has a vertex set, the arcs of S, and the simplex spans alpha 1 to alpha n, if and only if the geometric intersection number for each pair is 0. This gives us a connected and contractible complex. So I'd like to make a point now that it's sort of tempting to think the arc complex can be cut out.
I looked at my notes, and I don't know where I learned this problem, but I did learn that Friedson thought about it and used it out this
way. Okay, thanks.
So I don't know what you
Okay, so it's tempting to say yes to this question. And the reason why I think it's tempting to say yes is due to this following theorem. So I think there's a lot of names here that I should write. Bowditch and Epstein and Thurston and perhaps Penner and Mumford and Strebel. And I might even be missing a few names. So please tell me if I'm missing some names. And the theorem says, let there be some mark points at the surface. Then there exists a mapping class group equivariant homeomorphism from type Miller space plus a simplex to some dense subspace of the R complex. Okay? In fact, this subspace is just a union of interiors of a bunch of simplexes. This can be equipped with a Katsura metric, invariant under the mapping class group, and so this can. Let me draw an example. For the ones called torus, we have type Miller space, and this thing will be a point. And there's a tessellation of the type Miller space. And so on. And if you include the vertices, then we get the arc complex. If you take away the vertices, and you get this space. And these are all cut zero. So it's tempting to think that the R complex could be cut zero, but alas, that's not true in general. So theorem, let K be one of the following complexes. The R complex of a surface, but there are some topological constraints here. If the genus is large, then you only need at least two bunches for mark points. If the genus is small, then you just need sufficiently many mark points. It's the first example of complex for K in this theorem. Next is the disk complex of a handle body. Here I need the genus to be at least 5. And the third complex is the free spinning complex where the rank is at least 5. And the conclusion of the theorem is that K cannot be cut zero with finitely many shapes. As a corollary, if you take any finite index subgroup of the mapping class group, for instance, it will act co-compactly on the R complex. And so any finite index subgroup cannot have some invariant Katsura metric on any of these on the R complex in particular. So there is a remark that I should add here. But none of the already known obstructions will prove this theorem. Okay? So for instance, Bighton's theorem will tell you that Daintrous must act elliptically. Daintrous already acts elliptically on the complex. Maybe there's a coarse geometric obstruction being considered. Well, all of these complexes are hyperbolic. So Mesmer-Steinberg proved these are hyperbolic, and these are hyperbolic. Handel and Mosher proved that these complexes are hyperbolic. Maybe you could ask yourself, maybe there's a topological obstruction to being cut zero. All of these complexes are contractible. So Herr and Hatcher proved the R complexes are contractible. Hatcher showed the free spinning complex is contractible, and I think McCullough showed the disk. And finally, finite subgroups of these automorphism groups always fix points in each of these three complexes. And there's this nice notion of dismantlability that Hensel, Seidel, and Chetytsky use to prove that there are fixed point theorems here. So the remark is just to say no obstructions will prove the point. Story of how this theorem came about. It starts with a conversation with Andrew Putnam. So Andy is an excellent mathematician who turns coffee into remarkable theorems. On this occasion he turned beer into a remarkable question. So he asked, does the curve complex satisfy a linear combinatorial isoparametric inequality? When you first see that question, your reaction might be, well, we know the curve complex is hyperbolic by Mazur-Minsky. So, what's the problem? Well, there's a subtlety, because the curve complex is not locally compact. So we're in the delta hyperbolic setting. So what do we know? We know that if you take a big loop in the curve complex, then you can find some sort of net with only linearly many holes, so that each hole has length at most some constant depending on delta. I think it's 8 delta. It's equal to the figure. So this is how far the coarse gain function gets you. Whereas what Andy's asking, he wants to take each of these loops and fill them in with triangles, like in Damien Sider's talk.
Triangles and the two skeletons.
And the two skeletons, yeah. So what he's really looking for is a simplicial map of a triangulation of a disk capping off your loop with only linearly many triangles in the universe. So the combinatorial isoparametric inequality requires you to fill in with triangles. And in the case for Cayley complexes of finitely presented groups, and of course, the coarse and the combinatorial gain functions coincide, because you have local compactness, essentially. But in the curve complex, this can fail a priori, because the coarse and combinatorial might not agree, because it might be possible that there are loops of bounded length that require arbitrarily many triangles. So failing that, there exists loops Ln bounded length requiring least end times. To the form, to a point. In this situation, the combinatorial gain function is not even defined. So originally I answered this question first for the curve complex and for the arc in the curve complex. And here we're going to start varying the complex involved. And when we vary k, we actually find out that something surprising happens. So when k is the curve complex in the arc complex, the answer is yes. But if k is the arc complex or the disk complex, or free spinning complex in general, then the answer is no. And in fact, something really bad happens. There exist bad loops, arbitrarily bad loops of length 4. That's the worst possible. So length 3, just pound times. So what sort of tools go into proving these things? So I'll talk about the proof of this one today. And the tools it uses is a theorem from combinatorics called the Hex theorem, and also the notion of subsurface projection. Whereas on the other side, the proof is quite involved. So you need to know something called the Tynan procedure, and you need to have a detailed understanding of it. And then there's an analysis of tight geodesics and tight cats. So tight geodesics were mentioned by Mahan in this talk. Before I move on to this proof, I want to just say something about this and motivate it. I don't know the answer when k is the three-factor system complex. And I thank Martin Despina for pointing out this complex to me. It's a complex that's quasi-isometric to the three-factor complex. I think the answer is no for that complex. And the thing is if you can prove that the answer is yes for this three-factor systems complex, well, since I only understand how to get a yes answer using tight geodesics, maybe one could hope that if you prove the answer is yes here, there are some tight geodesics hidden somewhere in the room. And you need these tight paths to sort of prove results like asymmetricity, and it's not known for the three-factor complex. So maybe it could give us some insight to asymmetricity of the three-factor system complex. So the existence of these bad loops in the arc complex is precisely what gives us this theorem over here. So here's a proposition. Suppose that k is a cat zero, but not necessarily locally compact.
simplicial complex. With finitely many shapes. Then K satisfies a quadratic combinatorial isoparametric inequality. In particular, linear if K is hyperbolic. Okay, so if we combine this theorem here with the proposition, then we can prove this theorem here. So, what's a basic example of some non-locally compact simplicial complex where you can use this theorem? Let's take a very natural simplicial structure on the real line, and now let's take two points, one above and one below the line. And we can construct quite a big simplicial complex. And notice that this complex has finite diameter, but it has an undefined combinatorial isoparametric inequality. So, for instance, there are arbitrarily bad loops of length 4 that require arbitrary main triangles to deform into a point. And so this complex K can't be cut through with finitely many shapes. But on the other hand, it can be cut zero with infinitely many shapes, but we've just drawn it in the plane. And that's cut zero. So the theorem is sort of best possible in some sense.
Sorry, I think I dismissed this thing. So it has a cat zero metric because it's a true one, but it doesn't have one because it's infinitely many shapes.
It has a cat zero metric with infinitely many shapes, but not finitely many shapes.
In particular, there's a natural z action there.
Yeah.
Shape is an isometric simplex?
Sorry?
Is a shape an isometric type of simplex?
Yeah, shapes means, yeah, it's isometric type of simplex. So the finitely many shapes just means you're only going to see certain metrics in your simplex, out of finitely many. I'd just like to give some hint of the proof of this proposition. So we have to be very careful when we prove this proposition, because if complexes like being self-picking up there, they can be locally infinite. So the way you start the proof find an epsilon such that the following holds. So you want to take some sort of first barycentric subdivision of your simplicial complex, and in the first barycentric subdivision, each vertex has some sort of canonical neighborhood. Here it is. and you want to pick epsilon so that when you take the epsilon neighborhood of this neighborhood V, then it doesn't hit any other simplex that does not contain V. So you want some sort of property that says if these neighborhoods intersect a simplex, then in fact V is already in the zero space of the simplex.
What about the segment on the this is a simplex of the original lattice subject.
I didn't make that clear. Yeah, these syntheses are the original complex. Thank you. And now what's the game? You have to cap off any given loop in one skeleton. So we take this big loop and we chop it up into pizza slices. We do it in a rather strange way. We divide the pizza up in a very strange way. This is a commonly done thing. One of these lines, they are geodesics in the Katsura metric space. And I want the slices to be very thin, so epsilon over 2. And then all I need to do is just try to find a triangulation for each sliver, right? That involves only linearly many triangles. And I won't dwell on it, but
so it's not just any geodesic, you actually have a homing that you like for it.
These yellow lines are coming from geodesics in the Katsura space. It's a Katsura space.
Oh, sorry.
So the geodesics are unique. Right. Simply connected.
Very good.
So to tell you how to get triangulation, I first should tell you how to get just a superficial path corresponding to each geodesic. And you need to make sure that there aren't too many vertices along this path. So let's just take one of these geodesics and think about the appropriate picture in the complex. Let's say we're walking along this geodesic. So first of all, it starts somewhere from vertex. So how do you choose the next vertex along the path? Well, the answer is you wait for it. You wait for this geodesic to exit the epsilon over 2 neighborhood of this neighborhood of the barycentric subdivision. And because the complex is thick, it ensures that you only see linearly many vertices along this corresponding to this geodesic. So how does it work? We start with some vertex. Let's say it's vertex B. And you wait until the geodesic leaves a certain neighborhood of this neighborhood B. As soon as it starts leaving, you choose this W that you've just entered. That'll be W. And that tells you that this length is at least epsilon over 2. And so you're making certain progress for this initial path. So that's how you do these edges, but now you need to fill this in with triangles. And this is more complicated. But you use the cat zero inequality here. What you do is you sweep out this pizza slice with parallel lines. And because of the cat zero inequality, these lines will have length at most epsilon over 2. And what you can do is you can prove that if you have a vertex here and you have one of these lines and it comes to the other side, then you can show that there's an edge going like that. And just for reasons, I'm not going to try and explain this. But using this picture, you can prove this. So I think the statement, there's a lemma that says, as you sweep through this pizza slice with lines of length of most times, if you go past a vertex that hits this opposite edge, then there is an edge connecting this vertex and the next vertex. It's not very clear, I know, but you can ask if you want during the break. Okay, so this one is this guy. And so the triangulation that we'll get in this situation will look like this. Let's move on.
Sorry, the existence of epsilon is just because there's finite dimensions.
So yeah.
It depends on the shapes, not on anything else.
It depends on the shapes, yeah. So how do you prove the existence of such an epsilon and a barycentric subdivision? You start with the zero scattering of the complex and work your way up. And construct the barycentric subdivision. You only see finite dimensions, but at least as you get. So then there must exist an epsilon. Okay, so moving on, let's see why there are bad loops in the R complex. So we're going to do it for the R complex and the disk complex and the free spinning complex. But there's this very nice theorem of Hammerstadt and Hensel, which allows us to say that it will suffice to do just the R complex. So what did Hammerstadt and Hensel prove? They showed that there's a embedding of the arc complex into the disk complex, into the free spinning complex, but they also give you a one Lipschitz retract back. I really need the one Lipschitz here. So given some bad loops in the R complex, it will give you some bad loops in the disk complex, the length form, and also the free spinning complex. If you could cap these off with good disks, with a few triangles, then you just take Hammerstadt and Hensel's one Lipschitz retraction, and you'll prove that all the loops in the R complex are good. So that's why it suffices to find bad examples in the R complex.
embeddings, like isometric embeddings?
Yeah, that will follow from the dependent shift script action. Okay, so I'm ready to define the loops in the R complex. What I do is I take my surface, it has at least two punctures, so I can chop it in half. That's the first step. I chop it in half along some curve. I've got two sides. I've got a subsurface X and a subsurface Y. So what I do is I pick, what I do is I say, well, given some natural number n, I choose four arcs. I choose an arc A1 and A2x contain an x such that the subsurface distance in x between A1 and A2 is at least 3n. And I also do the same in Y. So how do these vertices look like in the R complex? Well, we have A1x, A2x, A1y, A2y, and they bound, well, they all lie on a loop of length 4. There are no edges between the diagonals, because these arcs are very far apart in these complexes, so particularly in the set. Suppose that you could cap this disk off with bounded Riemann triangles. I just want to give a good example for the triangulation. Okay. Well, there's a very important observation that we need here, which is that we can color each vertex red if a vertex V cuts the subsurface X. And color it blue if not, and that will imply that the arc V cuts Y instead. So the arcs in X are colored red. And these guys are colored blue because they miss X. And now we can color in the rest of this triangulation. Each vertex gets a color. Hexagon tell us. Hexagon will tell us there exists a monochromatic path. A1x, A2x, or A1y to A2y. How do you find such a path? Well, if you think of red as land and blue as the sea, just walk along the coastline. So here's a coastline. Here's the sea in the van, which is red for some reason. And you walk along the coastline. And that will give you a one manifold with boundary. And we know one manifold's with boundary, they should have two endpoints. So we follow along the coastline. Quite a long one. Where do I go now? Yeah. As soon as we have this arc, one of these two sides will give us a monochromatic path. And there it is. Okay? Now we use the notion of subsurface projection. And this back up here by the definition of our arcs to deduce that the path is at least 3n long. That implies we have at least n triangles in the disk. Something like n minus 5. Okay. So that's the end of the proof. Thank you very much. I'll stop that.
Yeah, this is maybe silly, but what about the pants complex?
Yeah, good question. I'm stuck.
It's a question of Jeff Brock whether or not you can add higher dimensional cells to get it to be cat zero on those. Mm. So as the complexity goes up, you need to add more and more cells. But I think it's still a good thing.
Yeah.
The suggestion is that the big Pearson metric should change.
Who knows?
Do you have a conjecture one way or the other regarding the hard complex?
Which?
To the
cat zero question.
Yeah, the cat zero question.
I'm hoping the answer is yes. I hope that there's a cat zero metric. I just don't know how to construct it. It's quite tricky.
Do you want to say a few words about the type of procedure and so on?
You start with a bounded length loop, and you do what Mahan was saying in his talk, reach length 2 subpath, replace the middle vertex by the boundary of the neighborhood of the two curves, and repeat that. And eventually, either you find a shortcut, and then the loop becomes simpler, and you win by induction, or you keep tightening, and then you get a tight loop. And then you prove there's only finitely many such tight links up to the mapping action of the mapping.